We're coming back on now.
Yeah, we're on. Jay Moore is now reliving the Paul Reiser walking into the studio bit. Louis C.K.'s in studio. It's been a very weird morning, Lou.
Award winner.
And we almost lost Louis C.K. because I guess you were supposed to be a surprise for us.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
I would rather you just know that our friend Louis C.K. is coming.
Yeah, I'm not a person that you surprise somebody with.
No, but I think that's Roland covering his ass.
Like, hey, look, it's your mailman.
Right.
Oh, my God!
Because I think he forgot to tell us that you were coming in, so all of a sudden he goes, it's a surprise. And then, just to get everyone up to speed, then Louis in the lobby, and he's tweeting that he's leaving if no one comes and gets him, because he was there since 9, because he dropped his kids off. And then he did leave while we went to break, and Roland had to do Heart Attack City to go find you.
Yeah, he looked pretty bad when he ran and found me on 7th Avenue.
How many blocks away were you?
Just a half a block. I knew he was going to come. I was being a complete asshole.
That's fine.
I knew that if I went half a block away, Roland would have to run.
Right.
You know, it's not fair because he's extremely efficient whenever I come here. So he sets a high standard. So, like, it's been 17 minutes. I'm like, what the fuck? Right. And then I get... I shouldn't have Twitter because you shouldn't be able to punch out your big, you know, your sudden thoughts.
But that's why Twitter.
Because I'm a little cunty.
Great. Yeah, I know. But
17 minutes is a long time, though. 5 minutes is
reasonable.
But
now that momentary cuntiness is in the Library of Congress.
Good. It got action. It should have been there. You should have waited. You should have done it for 8 minutes. I would have done that.
But it's our fault because we were beating up Roland for another thing. He's had a tough morning.
Yeah,
because
it
blew me
pocket,
off at the Charlie Sheen.
It vibrated like I'm fucking downstairs, right?
Or you can put the guy in the system, and then you just walk up, get your fucking pass, and come up.
Now, I'm looking at the cunty tweet. It says, all it says is, I'm waiting in the lobby to go on O&A. Rolling the bookers make me wait forever. I'm going home if he's not here in 1 minute.
That's cunty.
That's not right.
You just want to
make... He has a job. I have a job.
You just won a major award.
Yeah, a major award.
What'd you win? Congratulations.
I won an Oscar for...
Oh, see, I thought they were a while ago. I didn't realize you had that. There you go.
I was the best picture.
You're incorrigible.
Who'd you beat out?
I don't. Oh, you
were you even there?
I was there because they told me 3 weeks ahead of time that I won.
Win.
Otherwise, you would never go.
Of course.
And then the awards show sucks because everybody knew they won like a month before.
So
no one's like, oh, my God. They're like, yeah, so thanks. Mm. It was pretty shitty.
I didn't watch.
Who did you beat out?
It was dumb. I beat out a handful of other comedians. I don't remember... who they were.
Don't say no more.
It was Ricky. Ricky was one of them, and Whitney Cummings was one of them.
Beat out Ricky.
Yeah.
That's going to mess up your friendship, I'm thinking.
Yeah, I don't care about that.
No.
I'll trade awards for friendship with that guy any day.
Now, we're going to talk to Ricky in a little while, so it's not going to make sense that we only talk to Louis for 10, 15 minutes. But then when we replay the Ricky Gervais interview, whenever that's going to be, then you're going to hear Louis a little more.
Yeah, Louis will be here for the Ricky interview.
Right.
And for those of you listening now, you'll hear it in a few days. Fucking shut up.
And I would have been here for 40 minutes if
Roland's incompetence hadn't bungled again. Roland hadn't fucked everything up once again.
Roland's had a tough morning.
As he should, derailing this program.
He's going to come back down here again, man.
He's got to get in shape. Well, I mean, for his own sake. If you need to run half a block and you look that bad.
True. Mm. It's very rare, though, that he has to chase down cunty guests.
Nick Nolte tried to leave last week.
Oh, Christ. Yeah. Don't bring that shit up again.
It's not a great Nick Nolte.
He's working on it.
Amazing.
It's so
I've
much better than
Nick
at
Nolte
6
before.
O'clock. It's like Nick Nolte could sound someday.
3 hours later, it's right on.
Yeah.
It's been horrible.
It's Michael, like
I'm
yours.
Really good.
Are you fucking with me?
No, I'm serious. Well,
thank God
like
we showed up.
Yeah.
At 6:30, I rolled out Nick Nolte. It was so funny.
And they were shitting on it?
No, it wasn't anywhere close to that. He's been working on it all day.
Yeah.
It's been a progression all morning.
Yeah.
He's
and
got
like,
it now.
I've done this in my house, watching like Thin Red Line when he yells at Stavros. I got to take the... I'm not going to stop while I'm ahead.
I can polarize really
fast. That was pretty good.
Today.
Did you see Charlie... No one we know went to go see Charlie.
Exactly. Why would anyone go?
You went to see him?
No. I was going so I could talk about it.
Oh, you went.
Why not?
He wanted to go, and Roland didn't get his tickets because Roland took NyQuil and fell asleep for 16 hours.
At noon.
At
he took DayQuil, though.
But DayQuil doesn't put you to
thank
sleep.
Thank you.
That's exactly
the whole point. Why is it falling apart? Like Big A.
Who, Roland?
Yeah.
That's the whole point is it doesn't put you to sleep.
Right. Yeah. So his lies are falling apart. And
I could see going to the show for research. Yes, you're supposed to do that.
I would. I would check it out.
But I wouldn't.
I wouldn't go thinking I was going to see a great show.
No.
I wouldn't go thinking I'm seeing Louis C.K.
You know, the best reason to put Twitter down is fucking you are one tweet away from losing your job.
Well, from losing all to becoming infamous.
Yeah.
I mean, from really fucking... yeah, what's his name?
Gilbert.
Yeah.
Are you past the Palin stuff? Because some of your Palin...
Yeah, I got past that. I deleted those, too, so after a while... Because
your Sarah Palin tweets could have been your Gilbert Gottfried.
Yeah, they could have fucked me up. And I actually think if I did them now, like, that's how fast it's changing.
Oh, now they're...
Which
aware.
I said if I did them now, they'd in here...
What I say to Patrice in here?
About I'll tell you about what.
Oh, the thing of
how they named the thing.
The word
deal?
Nigger came from because some black guy was being a nigger. That's what I said to Patrice O'Neill.
Sorry, I had to hear that.
I don't care.
No, it's okay. The thing with Louis though is if he's on a plane, the tweets get fucking crazy.
Well, because I get when I'm on a plane, if I drink rum, I go to a different state of consciousness.
That's something they say, like, in the ghetto, like, no, only when I drink rum, I get a little bit crazy. Yeah. No, beer and wine am I.
Rum, forget it,
rum,
Ronnie.
Forget about it.
Now you drink the rum because you're scared to fly?
No, I just let it. Being on a plane is an opportunity to drink. I don't drink any other time.
Yeah, that's
do you drink to forget Lou or to dream greater dreams?
People do things on planes they don't normally do. You'll never see tomato juice anywhere but on a plane.
Yeah.
You know, well, I used to fucking have that before takeoff. Amazing story. Hold on, stop the room.
There's tomato juice all over the world.
No, but no one drinks it.
Tomato,
you can have a tomato juice right now, but
there
you don't.
There are gallons of tomato juice disappearing every second.
But I never drank it.
To planes.
I drank it because I'd be in first and I'd feel like a gentleman when they'd say, would you like a beverage? And I would have a tomato juice and then it just became a habit.
Yeah.
What?
Jimmy loves crazy.
What a fucking rump on her.
Yeah, she's got a big rump. Oh,
what's her story? She's an intern or producer or what?
No, she's a big juicy
guy. You've got to leave her alone. That could get us in trouble with the HR. I think that's an HR situation.
Yeah, you're not allowed to eat the ass of interns. It's frowned on in corporate America.
Jay Severance.
Say what happened.
Same exact thing you said the other day. I fucked my interns. He's gone.
That's it.
He's done. This radio host out of Boston. Were you there when you were there?
I don't know.
Maybe are you kidding? Are you serious?
No, it was in the paper.
We lost another guy.
Yesterday.
He fucked him?
At least he said he did. He said as a joke or maybe serious.
You can't fuck with interns.
No.
You fuck them.
They're very sacred. They're sacred people.
Yeah, they really are. They're a sought after commodity.
Yeah,
interns. Work for free, but don't fuck me.
What's wrong with him saying he?
Maybe he actually did fuck one.
So
who knows?
Then that's he's just telling the truth on a talk
so
show.
He's so horny.
Perfect.
That's really great drop. That's a great drop.
I don't even have the fucking thing in front of me.
It was perfect.
Yeah. Just so the timing of that was amazing.
That had the timing of Johnny Carson.
Yeah.
That was like...
Johnny used to have a 360 and just hit it all night.
We had a nice... you don't want to tell any more kids' stories? I loved your kid's story.
I've been talking for I talk too much. We all know I talk. There's no secret. I talk too much.
I loved your giraffe story. And then he goes, you're fucking with me. We're going to the bathroom. He goes, you're fucking with me with the giraffe story. Like, it was a great story.
Well, you also pulled off your Twitter, right?
Why are you so insecure?
Yeah, why are you insecure?
Yeah, Jay.
Why do you, when you get praised, why do you think it's somebody trying to hurt you?
It's been a very odd morning.
Yeah.
A lot of people have been getting praised. Not for real.
Right? Oh, really?
No, okay. Paul Reiser sat in that chair for about a half hour, the most uncomfortable interview
I've
ever heard.
No.
And on his bio,
made him feel like a loser.
I don't think he's used to being a public person anymore.
Is that what it is? Because we're trying to figure it out.
He's been a rich, very rich guy in a house by himself. I don't know if he has a family.
Right, because Jay says if you're a comic,
but
you should be able to...
I don't know anything about
it. I made that point before, though, yeah.
But Jay says
I like
you're a comic...
I like the fact that you're giving Louis credit for it.
You should be able to feel the room and go with it.
If you had
he hasn't been on stage in years.
He was stand up for over a decade, and he goes, and then I went out to Hermosa Beach, and I went on stage, and he points at me, and he goes, and you know, your comedy muscle gets fat. I'm like, what the fuck are you pointing at me? Like, I fucking.
Well, because he recognizes you as his comedian.
See, thank you.
He's saying, hey, you know, you would know, right? Because you're a comedian.
I wanted to say, no.
He's paying
I
you respect.
A little respect.
You really think he was like, I'm going to get aggressive with this kid on the radio?
No, I'm just doing it for a fucking gag.
I like you, you piece. Is shit.
I know. Yeah.
Just take a
but
shot.
But admit that you might have, you were over there giggling and fucking with your back.
But my
to
thing
him.
Was, if you're a fucking comic and you for fucking 10 years, if you go up on stage, if Louis doesn't go on stage for 10 years and you put him up on the cellar, you wake him up and say, "Go, just go fucking talk to people." He's gonna be fucking hilarious.
I disagree.
I don't. You worry.
Well, if I take a few weeks off, I get a little nervy. I don't want to go on. Yeah.
Yeah, but maybe the audience doesn't notice that.
If I don't go on stage for a while, I start having nightmares about bombing.
Really?
Wow. Yeah, like bad nightmares.
Wow.
Where I'm on stage in front of a huge crowd and I'm just going, like I can't get it out. And people are starting to go, oh, fuck. Like it's getting ugly.
Is it always the same room?
It's different. Sometimes it's an outdoor thing. Because those you can't control outdoor.
Yeah,
stand-up.
And they're typically good comedy venues.
Yeah.
Yeah, wonderful.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Comedy doesn't need a roof. Let it breathe. Yeah. It's like the same way with the Grateful Dead. It's easier for people to stretch out a little bit.
Let it breathe.
You bring blankets. Nice
well,
setup.
Thank you.
I do blame Jay Moore for the polarizer thing going bad because he did the half slice thing.
All right. We were talking about.
I'm bringing this up because maybe.
When we started the show. Jimmy was talking about he had pizza last night with Colin. It was the first time Jimmy had pizza in years. And Jimmy, like, very childlike and wonderful enthusiasm, goes, pizza's fucking delicious. Like, it was amazing. It was
beautiful. It's been a while since I've had it.
It was the purest. Like, I wasn't teasing him. It was amazing how funny
I said pizza fucking rules.
Pizza. Pizza fucking rules.
Yeah.
And then I said, we were talking about there's no good pizza in Manhattan. And then I said, you know, Chelsea, something about Chelsea. And then Ronnie did something about a gay guy ordering pizza.
Have a half slice. And that's the new thing that we're trying to get to take off.
Yeah, we're trying to get half slice. But just something about a gay guy ordering a half slice.
Why is that funny?
I don't know.
Because they want the whole cup.
Why would he order half a slice? But somehow I believe it is like a trope that's been around for years.
Keep his washboard stomach.
It makes sense because he's gay. Slicer, like. Yeah.
We just don't know why.
Can I have a half slice?
And I pictured like five like beautifully dressed like gay guys and like they're mulling around. The guy goes, yeah, it's gonna happen. Cool. Who's that? And the guy going, oh, you have half slices. Like they
gotta figure out how to go in on half slices.
Louis knows exactly why I was laughing at that. Paul Reiser sits down, he goes, so how's everybody doing? And I go, and I just look at Paul Reiser and go, yeah, half slices.
But here's the thing.
I start laughing so hard. It's like, I don't know if you've ever done
that. And he doesn't know why you're doing it.
Right. Exactly. Now here's the thing. With Louis, you showed him the respect, you told him the backstory.
Right.
And now he's part of
it. That's exactly it. So you
welcome. Like a trench.
You blindsided him
right.
With the half slice
with
thing.
With the half slice right. thing. Right. And you know what it's like
he
to walk
know.
In and like, you know.
Okay.
When you walk in
what
to a radio
like
place.
Me?
Are you going to let anybody else say fucking anything?
I know. I have a problem. I've been talking.
I know.
I'm sorry.
You walk in now. It's too quiet.
No, it's good. You stood your ground.
Now you.
You're not going to take anymore.
See, the weirdness takes over everybody. See what happened there, Ron?
This is an aggressive room.
Wow.
You've been on radio shows where you walk in and then something's been going on. You don't know what it is.
Yes.
And if some young guy takes a shot at you, you're like, what the fuck is this place? And yet, he paid you a respect by throwing you a, hey, you know what it's like. You're a pro. About the Hermosa
still
Beach
wasn't
thing.
Enough. No.
And you're
that
still like, oh, what does he mean? It's because you live moment to moment. You're like a dog. You live moment to moment. You don't give anybody any credibility, and you don't take any responsibility for your own actions. You
that's
just live moment to moment. You don't like an energy, you respond. That's it.
I take full responsibility for my actions.
Well, it's easy to just say that out loud.
You live like a dog.
You don't actually do it.
But it is true. You have no past or future. You don't care about it.
That's how dogs experience life.
And E-Rock just told me we
have
8 minutes.
8 minutes for what?
What the fuck? Because we got to do the Ricky Gervais thing right at 10.
Great, excellent.
People get a bitch when we don't go past 10.
Fuck them!
No. Perfect day to go
don't
past 10,
don't hear more
but
of this
can.
Fucking fantastic fucking...
some kind of dogs.
Later this on this week?
Yeah. What? You get it? Did I miss anything?
What kind of dog?
All dogs are like... What do you mean what kind?
Like, he wants to know what kind of dog he lives like.
There isn't a vast difference in brain structure.
Right.
No, between a fucking
you,
shepherd and a...
Although with cocks, there certainly is a difference.
Yeah, everyone looked around the room like, what kind of dog is each guy?
Stop.
Yeah,
well,
stop.
We don't want to do it.
What is this?
Don't make us do
that's
that.
That's fucking high talk.
You've been doing too many morning zoo shows.
Driving to a fucking gig?
What's wrong with you?
Right.
I like the half slice thing, though, because it's like they have to get slices in pairs.
Right. Like, can it's I have like, two half slices?
Can I have a half slice? Will you go in with me? Because he won't give me a half.
He's going with the half slice.
But you know
and, and the Greek pizza guy hates when they fucking come in.
Yeah.
Get stuck with a half slice. Come in with your faggot friend. I'll give you each a half
Malacca.
Slice. Don't make me give you one.
Malak, I can meet you with the half slice.
We haven't talked to Louis since the. Thank you for reminding me. The Rumsfeld thing. Lizard.
Oh, that's right.
That
oh,
fucking
God,
thing took off.
Uncomfortable.
That really blew up.
Another uncomfortable day that I really enjoyed. I think you were
that
losing
was
Anthony.
Really fun.
Because Anthony wanted the real interview with Donald.
He wanted to be friends with him.
Yes, he did.
He really did, didn't he? Because he was doing a beautiful
I think that's fair enough to say. He did a great interview.
The thing.
He did a great interview.
But also, he was facilitating me because he kept him from hanging up. He got me.
Right. To the place
10 shots to answer that, to ask that question.
So you left us, and then that video goes viral. Do you get any feedback from that?
Well, I get both. I get some people that
want to kill
it,
you, right?
And I get all kinds of angry, you know, you fucking unpatriotic piece of shit, that man. You know, like they act like he fought all the wars that he planned. Like he was there.
Just trying to have fun with him.
Yeah, just
make
having
a little
good time.
Different form.
And he had the most amazing non-answers of anyone I've ever seen interviewed ever, like in press conference.
Oh, yeah.
At a podium, I mean. Like the most.
He's the best at that. Young.
Ronnie, you heard this, right?
Yeah, even the fact that day that he didn't freak out or get pissed or hung up, I mean, he's like such a pro.
It's because he's in control. Lizard person. He doesn't need. He could destroy the planet any second. He's here just as amusement. Mm. But he could take us all out.
That was an amazing day. Are you a lizard?
It was really fun.
Animated by Coke Logic. So if you follow Coke Logic on Twitter, I'm sure he'll tweet the link for everybody today. What else you been up to? You filming the show? Second season?
Yeah, second season.
Is it going well?
Yeah, except for I'm running out of shit to shoot. I'm writing it myself, so after next week I got nothing. Because I can't write right now. Like, I'm not coming up with any shit.
Go with Half Slice.
It's good,
it's
right?
Yours. It is yours.
Good, good.
We're going to give him Half Slice, Ryan, just
half
like
slice.
That?
And then here's the thing, too. It's like, you have a Half Slice? No. You got a quarter? And then that'll be, boom, fade to black. You have a quarter, and then we're done.
Right into Louie.
Yeah.
Louie just ate. He doesn't want a full slice. Maybe the guy can hook him up with a half slice. So I'm really not that hungry, but I don't want to be rude and not eat.
So how many episodes short are you going to be if you don't start writing?
Well, I just don't have. I mean, I've shot about seven. Huh. About a half, a little over half. But it's just, we have nothing. We have a crew. And, it, you know, it costs us like $90,000 a week just to exist as a
company.
You're
doing this like we do our radio show? You're just making it up as you go along?
Yeah, I'm not supposed to, but that's kind of the way it's working out.
Louis has
that
the greatest
could either be really.
I backlogged a lot of material, but it melts quick. It's like when you have a plan a snowball fight.
Yeah.
When you're a kid and you make 1,000 snowballs.
Yeah.
And they're gone in like 2 seconds. After a while, you're just grabbing snow and
rocks.
Fucking throwing it.
Yeah,
rocks.
You go to the rocks and sticks.
That's
at that
where
point.
I'm at now. I'm
you seem to
rocks.
Have a great gift of autonomy. Like, you just are able to do the show autonomously. Is that
nobody tells me. I mean, I write this stuff and I give it to the producer and we start.
That's great.
Doesn't exist anywhere else. But it's hard because, like, I wrote something last night because I need shit.
Holy shit.
And and I think it's good, but I don't know, and there's nobody to check with. So I can email it to my producer and we'll be shooting it next week.
Want to tell
but
us?
It might stink.
We could be filters for you. Want to do it?
Well, yeah, but we're on the radio.
I know. Oh, you mean off mic, maybe?
Yeah, I can't.
Were you really happy with the first season? Because I thought it was fucking amazing.
Yeah,
I thought it was amazing.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
I loved it, but it has to be better now. It has to be, it's only
sophomore
jinx,
you're thinking?
Well, I just think you have
Does that
to,
scare you?
You have to improve for a second season.
You've been writing for so many years, though, man. You know how to not run out of ideas. You've been writing for 30 years.
Yeah, but they run out sometimes.
Oh, not with you, they don't. Be fine. Who's got a script? Who's always got a brilliant idea? Always.
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
How is we're going to talk to Ricky in about 3 minutes. We have to leave, unfortunately. This you're going to hear the second half of this sometime this week. It's getting weird.
If you're lucky.
But how is the new Ricky Gervais show? You were on the first episode, right?
I think it's just the one. I don't think it's a series. Is it?
Oh, I thought it was a.
I don't know.
Wrong. I don't think they're doing more than just the one.
I've seen it, and I know what
What's
they
that?
Showed.
Why did he stop doing extras?
It was done.
He only does 12 and done.
Yeah, but is the Ricky Gervais show, the animation, isn't that third season now?
Yes.
Yeah, that's going a while.
But where he has to be on camera, it seems. Like, the original Office was fucking 13 if you include the final, and so is extras.
And it was gone. And that was,
Is Ricky coming back to the Office? I know he's
I
doing...
I have no idea. Uh-huh. I don't know.
Let's look in your eyes.
But I don't know anything. No, I don't.
We want a
but
big
no, the
scoop
thing
today.
With Jerry and Chris was amazing.
It was you, Jerry, and Chris Rock.
And Ricky.
And Ricky was kind of leading the discussion.
Yeah, he was.
And what, you guys were just talking about comedy?
For 5 hours, we just sat and talked about comedy.
And then they cut
and
it,
they cut
an
it
hour?
Down to an hour, yeah.
Holy shit.
And it was intense. It was really fun.
It was interesting. And normally for me to watch comics...
Yeah, it makes you puke.
Talking
right?
about comedy, there's always one who's going to wax philosophically. You don't want to spit in his face, but it was really good, man.
That's the way to do it, though.
That.
5 hours, cut it down to an hour.
Really? Well, Jerry and Chris have something in common that they love comedy. I feel the same way. We love talking about it. Like, and we all just love, it's, you know, I remember every comedian I've ever seen. I remember everybody's bits.
top five comedian. Another list. Now, who was one of your guys when you were growing up?
Bill Cosby was one of my favorites.
Storyteller.
Yeah. And Steve Martin.
Really?
I loved, yeah.
Why Steve?
Just he came out of left field.
Funny, man.
No, I'm asking Louie, though.
There could be more to it.
Some people forget that Steve Martin was an amazing comic
and
filling out arenas. So I'm asking.
Very original.
It's funny to listen now because it really was like the context that the stand-ups were doing, like stories or like George Carlin, guys like that.
Love Carlin.
And then Steve Martin just acted like a fucking goof. He was just weird.
Well, and I know what Louis is saying is that when the gong would start for that song, all of our comedy blood just kind of got flowing. <when you moved. laughs>
Here's the thing with Steve Martin, though, that was so like amazing is like he made fun of being fucking funny. Like he made fun of the fact that you were even at a show.
Yeah.
It made the whole fucking thing feel nuts.
But are you sure that's what happening, or was he really not that funny?
No.
Were people just on Quaaludes that's laughing at a guy with an arrow?
He was
it's like Peter Frampton now. You look back and go, what the fuck was everyone so excited about?
I think he was better at comedy than Peter Frampton.
We have 10 seconds, and this fucking show is going to cut off.
Louis C.K. is a great comedian.
It's just going to end like that.
Why does it have to end like that? Why can't we just talk and stop it?
Why does it have to end like that, E-Rock?
Why?
Opie and Anthony Show on the virus. Sirius XM. The virus, SiriusXM. Follow the Opie and Anthony Show online. Facebook.com/Opie and Anthony. Twitter.com/Opie Radio. Twitter.com/Anthony Cumia. And Twitter.com/Jim Norton. This is the Opie and Anthony Show.
All right, we're back. And in studio, Ricky Gervais. It's an all-star lineup. You got Louis C.K., Ricky Gervais, Ronnie B., Jim Norton, and Jay Moore. Oh, my God.
Hello.
How are you, Ricky?
Very well, thank you.
And you walk in the room, and everyone just starts talking about how much weight you lost.
Yeah.
And that it could be because maybe something's
not
wrong with you.
Way.
I was saying that he looks AZ for
what
a fat
he said.
Guy.
Yeah.
I was being polite.
Lots
but
of half slices.
Brilliant. A lot of half slices.
Half slice. Half slice.
Look at you, you big fat slob. Just
yeah, I'm eating.
You've got no regard for people listening.
This is what Ricky does when I'm with. He starts shitting on me because he's deflecting negative attention from himself.
Atta boy, Lou.
He thinks I'm an easy target because I'm kind of heavy and I eat in front of people.
But
I'm a little messy.
Say. It's not going to bother you.
Louis runs like 10 miles a day. Do you still run?
Not these days, no.
I saw Louis like in a locker room in Las Vegas, and he just got off a treadmill like for 12 miles.
I used to run a lot.
What are you doing? And then he goes right into like a Waffle House.
That's right.
And he said you run so you can eat that way.
That's right.
Oh, really?
Maintain a shitty health.
Fuck, that's a smart way to do it.
That would kill me if I didn't exercise.
That's
it would
smart.
Kill me.
That's smart.
Yeah.
I've never...
But you're pretty fit, though, aren't you? You box and you run around.
I box and train.
But you're naturally big as well, aren't you?
I have a big body, yeah.
I always think of Louis. You know the thing in the Fantastic Four? It's like you peeled off all the lumpy bits, and that's what you're left with, Louis C.K. Totally fit.
More or less.
Ricky, how much did you lose? Let's get it out of the way.
Jeez.
You know how much you lose. You're trying to act like
a
casual.
You're so what I am now. I was... you got to convert this for you Americans.
Americans.
Yeah. I was 13 stone... 13.
Stone.
Say no more.
Yeah. I don't know.
Worthless country of fucking
And now
idiots.
I'm 12 stone 3.
You lost 5 quid.
Stone.
So you lost less than a pound?
He actually lost Sly and the Family Stone. And
sits in a big scale and they put rocks on the other side of the scale. That's how fucking shitty your
Brilliant.
Dumb country is.
Brilliant. Yeah, you've nailed us. Well done. Perfect. Brilliant. Aren't the English stupid for having empirical
You started with, oh, you Americans. I have to convert this for you.
Yeah, that's what pissed
Americans.
Off Louis.
That got me going.
Yeah. How's that an insult?
I'll be the ref. That's what pissed off Louis.
I knew the differences between our weight systems.
Nah, you insulted him a little bit yourself.
Yeah.
You got a little out of yourself.
De Niro coming through.
Louis doesn't go for the anti-US shit. He never has.
No.
Thank you.
All right.
What are you having there?
Yeah.
Should we start?
What are you having?
We started.
Yeah, we're already
what
taping.
What did they bring you? What are you having? I want to know what that
this is. This
is
radio. No one knows who brought me anything.
Well, I'm telling you, somebody brought...
Someone brought you something.
We got these hot chicks in here. Look at all these hot babes lined up on the wall.
Hey! Wacky time! For the big Ricky Gervais interview. Now we need to know what you're drinking, because now we did bring it to the attention of everybody.
This isn't radio.
Well,
it's a cup of tea, and they brought me some milk to put in it. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, just Let's have a conversation. Let's have a conversation.
Do you prefer skim milk now that you look better?
Yes.
Yeah, I do too.
Oh, this is good practice when I do The View.
Your show is good. I saw the episode.
Thank you.
Fucking great, man.
That's what I'm here for.
Normally, comics, me and Louis said, normally listening to comedians talk about comedy is revolting. But it wasn't, honestly, it was fucking really insightful, and everybody was honest. It was fucking great. Well,
let's get the name of this.
I really enjoyed it. It was really good fun. I was really worried that there'd be lots of talking over each other, and but it was good because we really came at it from four different points of view as well. Louis was, I'll do it in his face. Louis was great. He was brilliant because, because it was like he wasn't doing it like he was on television. Do you know what I mean? I think that's his life, though. I think in most things,
you
he
got some
does,
in your eyebrow. You like got like a not- crumb in your eyebrow.
Look, I want to get the basics out. It's called Talking Funny. It's on HBO. Is it a one and done? Because that's what we can't figure out.
Well, at the moment, we'll see how it goes down.
Okay.
But then we could do some more with better comedians.
And it's you, Louis C.K., Chris Rock, and Jerry Seinfeld.
That's right.
It picks up from mid-conversation. It just starts, like, literally, like the first half was chopped off, and they just, which is great, because there's no lead-up. They're just talking.
That's kind of what it was like, wasn't it? Because we sat down, and they mic'd this, and we're all chatting already from, we started talking in the hallway. All four of us. They start corralling us to our seats, and we don't even notice the difference. We're sitting in chairs, and somebody's mic'ing us. And we just kept talking, and I think at some point we realized we've been on the show now for 40 minutes or something.
Yeah.
Because it was like 5 hours, wasn't it?
Felt afterwards, I thought, I wasn't really funny, and I didn't talk about comedy. Because I was thinking, this is a TV show, we better have something to talk about. But it just sort of flowed. And we talked for about 4.5 hours, didn't we?
Yeah.
Wow. And then cut it down. So it's nice and tight. And
what are you going to do with the other 3.5 hours? I think a lot of comedy fans would love to hear that.
Yeah, we've got that. A lot of that, at one point, Louis just shat his pants. So we had to clear it out.
I had to take that out.
Really funny.
I do that every, that's part of my maintenance.
Ricky's done this before with Gary Shandling. That was the most amazing,
that was crazy.
Uncomfortable, hysterical.
He went to Gary Shandling's house.
Yeah.
And Gary Shandling looked cagey and felt invaded. And it's the two of them talking and Gary just not letting Ricky have a conversation with him, really.
I think.
And then he left.
I know.
It's fascinating. It's amazing.
Where did you see that?
It was sort of in a different place then. And he spoke to me afterwards and he said, I tried something. It didn't quite work. Mm. So I think that.
Was he doing a character?
I think he thought we were filming for his DVD at one point, because we were going to do that as well. So I think he was sort of in a different sort of place for it. But, it's interesting. I left in all the awkward bits. I think you've got to.
Well, yeah, what is there to try during an interview? Someone's interviewing you, like, I tried something. What? Okay, answer the question.
Well, he kind of tried being unpleasant, just like he's acting like he didn't want to do it. But it's fascinating. It's like a great hysterical interview, and you're just like, I'm so glad I'm not there. I'm just glad I'm watching, it's great.
Well, yeah. I didn't want to sort of come back at him too much, because I'm this young pretender seeing my hero, and I thought it would have looked really bad, so I don't know if I, did it look like I was sort of caught in the headlights a little bit?
Yeah, but it looked like you were enjoying it. It looked like you were, taking some shots from a guy that you're like, this is still great that I'm here
house. The thing about it that's fun to watch.
Yeah.
That he's slinging these horrible comments at you.
They weren't that
And you're
bad,
kind
were
of, you're
well,
kind
I was
of giggling.
Laughing.
Yeah, you're
right.
Laughing.
There's nothing funnier than being insulted.
Right.
There is
right.
nothing. If someone insults me,
You get excited, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Well, not in that way, but yeah.
Do you,
what way?
Oh.
Ricky, do you like being uncomfortable?
You get a boner when people insult you.
I love being uncomfortable. I think Louis loves it.
He gets an erection when people insult him. That's what we're trying to infer. Yeah. He gets a hard penis.
What is it? What's it about
when
being
people insult
I'm glad you quantified that.
Because his father
that,
used
sure
to
do
it. His father used to say, "You piece of shit," and then he would get really hard and he'd go jack off and come in his room.
Well, when he said so an erection, I'm still flaccid. That's my version of an erection.
He gets his softer.
Do you jerk off on your?
Yeah, it goes softer in fact, but then
Do you jerk off on your back or your stomach?
Some guys lay on their stomach. Yeah,
I know.
But Oh, you mean laying on my back?
Yeah.
I thought you meant like a fountain.
No.
It goes up and I catch it like David Beckham doing ball tricks. Hey, what's this? Yeah.
The bicycle kick. The bicycle kick with his own cum.
That's right.
Oh, it's like radio.
Why do you like being uncomfortable?
Well, I don't like being uncomfortable. I don't really get uncomfortable.
I like when the situation's uncomfortable. Well, maybe not me personally.
I think being embarrassed is almost admitting it. If you come out of a, you know, you're a party and you come out of the toilet and you've got a piss stain and everyone's sort of like, you know, not saying anything and you look down and you see it, that's just embarrassing. If you come out and go, look, I pissed myself, there's no embarrassment.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
Why do you have a piss stain when you go to the bathroom?
Oh, exactly. And on the back of the front.
I told you, I've been doing cum tricks. And I popped it away too quickly.
You just piss through your pants? You just let it go through your... Why do you even go to the bathroom?
I filter it through. Like when your nan used to strain sort of jam through...
My nan.
Stockings.
Yeah.
Oh.
That's right, my nan. I forgot about my nan. Again.
Yeah. Don't forget who invented English.
It's not about the words. It's we don't have nans. We had parents, and then we raised ourselves. We didn't have fucking nan. What the fuck is it?
I don't mean nanny. I mean gran. I mean grandmother. That's
right,
our word for gran.
I don't know what that is.
All right, then say parents.
I don't know what that is. Brilliant. Me I don't
nan.
Know what that is.
Me nan.
Jesus Christ.
And over here, we all call our grandparents different things than even our neighbors. Like, we don't have a catchphrase for that.
Right.
People go mum, mum, pop, pop, pay, pay. This makes shit up for grandparents.
Your grandfather is just the guy who molests you.
Oh, that's sad.
I didn't mean to ruin the movie.
Not only that.
It was sad. It was
not
sad.
Only that. Yeah, on yourself.
Do you feel bad when you feel bad when you liked it though?
No, not at all. I kind of egged it on.
That's why there's shame.
Those diapers fell up by themselves.
That's why there's shame, because it feels good.
Sure there is.
Oh boy.
You guys invented incest too over there, didn't you?
It is very popular. It is very, very popular, actually. Mm-hmm. Only in sort of like the sort of more the countryside, mm-hmm. I suppose. Paedophilia is definitely more popular in England than America.
I thought you said a guy's name, Peter Philly.
Pete from Philly.
Pete, you're on the air.
Peter Philly is very popular.
Don't you ever edit what comes out of your mouth? You have a thought. And
why
you,
do
no,
that?
Don't bother saying that.
Why
no.
do that?
That's not ready. That's not ready for an anecdote yet. Let's keep that in there for
why
a
Why do that? What kind of fucking shit would that be? No, I don't.
That's right. That's why your new CD is called No Filter. I want to feel bad about that, but I don't. I just can't.
Do people sort of listen going to work in their cars to show? Do you get any feedback about this?
Oh, yeah.
What are they
no,
like
they've yes. been on the air for like 20 years. Yeah. They never got any feedback.
I don't think it's going out.
No.
They really don't think. It's like some big practical joke.
If you need to know, we won't be looking at feedback today, Rick.
I want to do that with Celebrity Big Brother or something like that. They go in there, then after 6 weeks, you say we weren't filming
any of it.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah, you just wasted 6 weeks of your
How
PR.
How great would that be?
Yeah. That would be so great.
The people still don't know who you are.
That would be so
be great.
Great.
And
just
then would the real show be filming them after?
Yeah, exactly.
Them?
Yes, the real show would be watching
All right,
their
no
reaction.
No filter. I'm talking to a heavy hitter here. Relax.
You're talking to who?
A heavy hitter here. Oh. You know.
You should film them though. You have to film them anyway. You can't just not film them. You have to film them telling you did, and then film the rest after.
Jim Rickey.
No, that you didn't get them.
No, I know, but you weren't painting the whole picture. You fucking telling them a shit show. I'm trying to fucking help you. You pitch a bad show.
He's working on it.
What the fuck is bad about it?
Just film them after? What if some shit happened during? You got to film them during and just lie to them. What, are you going to tell them the truth? Like, we really didn't film you? Then you're wasting a cruise time.
You're being greedy. I think the thing you have to do is really put people in a room for like 3 months and tell them that they're on a show that's going to be huge and don't film it.
Yeah, exactly.
And don't film their reaction. Just for yourself, enjoy
Can't
shitting
you film
on those
it and
people.
Show them their face when you told them.
No, don't film that either.
Film
just enjoy that.
No one will ever know about it. No one will ever know what happens.
Just an enormous dinner box. Yes. Don't even just let it go out by word of mouth.
Yeah. Send messengers out.
If somebody could figure out a way to advertise on word of mouth, that would be really something. Cool. You're not allowed to tell this story unless you say, you know, buy a Buick or something like that.
Yeah. I want you to do that with them.
Yeah, what?
Starving Africans.
I wanted to hit the
give them T-shirts with like Office DVD still available or something. So then when you saw them on the news thing, they were sort of they were getting free clothes and stuff.
Right. But, and then you say, please feed this kid.
Yeah.
And people are like, oh, fuck, The Office is still out there.
Yeah. Exactly.
You still get that. That's what you would advertise, is that your show from 20 years ago is still on DVD.
Well,
that's what you would advertise.
Okay, Talking Funny on HBO the 22nd.
There we go.
Of April.
Of April.
9 p.m.
Yeah. We started talking about that, didn't we?
What?
I
don't know what else.
Oh, yeah.
There was different. There was different philosophies. The interesting part is to hear, Jerry's philosophy is a lot different about keeping the act than Louis, who flips his act every year. And it was just interesting to hear them kind of fucking banter that back and forth.
I couldn't get over that. Jerry is like the Rolling Stones.
He just hits.
He goes to sort of Vegas and he tours around and he never commits anything to DVD.
Doesn't it get boring?
I think he's sort of...
No, he loves the
It's
bits.
An evolution,
he loves
isn't it?
Them.
Yeah.
He loves
and
the bits to the
people
point.
Come to see him and
the act.
That's right. He does that thing.
The Rolling Stones like just playing the hits? Or you think they would really want to get up there and fool around?
Well, somebody told me they... guy I know who knows... none of this is true, but whatever. I was told by somebody... As I'm going down the road of the credibility of the story, you realize this fucking nut is very thin.
I need to hear it anyway now.
But somebody told me that Keith Richards has a guitar for every song, and the guitars are tuned, pre-tuned, instead of having the regular six-string tuning. They're tuned so he can just put one finger across the board and just play the chords.
Five strings. He takes the six
strings. Takes the six string and he just plays so he can just be barely awake and just be running through the...
Would you go...
I don't know if that's fun.
Would you go crazy if you weren't changing up your act?
Louis, hold on.
Yeah, I think I would have quit if I didn't start
I think
doing
the person that told you that was Keith in his book.
That's... Oh, did he say that in his book?
It's a huge chapter about...
So it is true.
I take the six string up all my guitars. That's why you can't pick up a guitar in a guitar shop and just play Start Me Up. It sounds weird because there's six strings.
He uses the six string to tie off with. That's right. As a kid. And then he's always right.
Are you criticizing Louis for telling that story? Like, he's like, all right, keep this under your hats. I got to fucking get the inside skinny on the stones.
I knew a guy. Check this out. We're scalping Mets tickets. We're in Queens. The guy comes up to me, tells me Keith Richards' story. Now, I can't vouch for the guy. But yeah, you managed a band called Suede?
Well, yeah, sort of.
Oh, my God.
Sort of how?
Well, you managed? I helped him out, and then that comes out once you're, now...
You could say famous.
You can say Ricky.
Yeah. It hurts, doesn't it? It makes me feel slightly weird.
You're a celebrity.
Yeah. You're a shiny star.
Yeah.
You're stars a shining,
don't fall from the sky,
shining.
Do they?
No, they don't.
So are you now.
You're a sparkly star.
Yeah.
You won the comedy award, didn't you? You beat me.
Yeah, I did beat you.
Best stand-up.
You and Whitney Cummings.
Yeah, no, deserved.
So
you deserved it.
There was only three people nominated for comedian.
Yeah,
who was the fourth?
Others. That's just I just remember Ricky because I like him. I remember Whitney for the other thing. What?
Who was the fourth?
Slappy White was in there doing great. I don't remember the other one.
Stephen Hawking.
Did you know it all?
Father Guido Sarducci.
He should have won. He says things funny.
He says I'm a funny. I don't know. I mean, that was a dumb thing. The awards. It was stupid.
It's nice.
It was. It's the first time they did them, and nobody cared.
24 hours later, you take a shit all over their nice program. They just gave you a fucking award. Yeah. Show some gratitude.
Did you even turn up?
What if I give you an award?
You have to say nice things about me? I say nice things about you.
I'm curious to hear, man. Here's the water award. You never say anything bad about me. I gave you the water award.
Louis, incredible.
It's beautiful.
But what award is worth something, though? It's only a matter of, like, how long it's been going, how credible it is, who turns up. You
That's
know.
Right.
It's still the opinion of, was it voted or?
What's the award? They told everybody 3 weeks ahead of time that they won, and then you showed up, and it was like 3 weeks ago, and then it was on the news that people won.
I was canvassing right up to the day. I wasted £1 million phoning everyone I ever knew.
What did they hand you, Louis? What did the award look like?
Did you turn up?
Yeah, I went because it's down the street from my house.
Thank you, I'm Louis C.K. I may look cynical on the outside.
That's right, I said my name too.
Can I be friends with you? I know
that's
Ricky
Gervais,
he's famous. I want to be famous.
That's
I know
right,
Chris
and
Rock as well. I've got a watch by Chris
that's
Rock.
Right.
He came here.
Oh my
you
God.
Fucking.
Oh my God.
That's brutal.
He really is saying that you say one thing, but you're really a speech-making cunt at the award show.
No, it's true. It's
mostly
true.
I want to thank the other nominees. Whitney and Ricky. They're just right. And whoever the fucking fourth guy is that we don't know.
I like that I identify myself during that speech, though. Oh, I'm Louis C.K. Like, I would say my own name.
Like he's an immigrant cleaning houses.
Oh, hello. I'm Louis C.K.
Thank you. Oh, I love Louis. I shared a plane ride with him once, right? It's on YouTube, and look it up. It's Ricky and Louis goes to New York, right?
That's right.
And it was when we were filming The Invention of Lying. Shut the fuck up, right? And we were living in Lowell, weren't we?
Lowell, Massachusetts.
Yeah. Thoughts? It's all right,
about
wasn't it?
Lowell?
Yeah.
It's a met Mickey Ward there.
I know.
No, sir.
Yeah, he traveled with me and trained me for the special I did the next year. He went on the road with me and trained me as a boxer for my special. Yeah, Mickey's an amazing guy. But I met him, he was driving trucks for the show, for the
movie.
He
still is, I think.
Yeah, he's a working guy.
Yeah.
And then we were on a private jet.
That's right. Ricky had a private jet that the company gave him, and it flew to New York. And we're here.
Those are two words that don't go together. Private jet, lol.
Yeah, no, not very much. Yes. We were the only private jet to ever land in... Well, we didn't
land in
Lowell.
They're all in the plane tree.
They took off until they fell over like penguins.
Yes.
It was...
And we were here in New York, and I was getting a ride back with him, and he was getting pissy because I was late. And I was late because my dog got hit by a truck.
No, you weren't. No,
yes, I was
late. No, wait. On the way there, he's late. I'm waiting for him. It turns up, he's forgotten his phone. We have to go back for his phone. It turns out he hadn't forgotten his phone. He'd forgotten another phone. He had the phone on. But then he's forgotten his keys. So now we have to wait for him to go
and pick
his keys
up. That was on the way here.
Absolutely. A shambles. I mean, it's ridiculous.
Sounds like a comedy of errors.
It was, honestly. But he doesn't care. He doesn't say sorry. He just goes, oh, I don't
know. I said sorry. What do you mean I didn't say sorry?
I lost my money, right?
That's how I talk?
Yeah. And honestly, you have never seen anyone so scared as him on this plane. It is amazing. I'm scared too, but because he's more scared than me, I'm laughing, thinking we're going to die. And he was sweating.
Bad turbulence. Yeah.
He was trying to get drunk really quickly.
Yeah.
Just sweating.
And he filmed it.
It was amazing.
If you get sick, all that bouncing around makes me nauseous. I take Dramamine when I fly.
The things he was shouting. He was shouting. What
the most disgusting things in history, yeah.
Fuck your mother, put a frog on your cock and fuck your mother. Hitler fucked his wife. 10-year-old gay kids. Fuck, being racist.
How does that help you, though? How does
that help? It takes me out of my fear.
Mm-hmm.
Just being racist.
That's his happy place.
Really?
I didn't say anything racist.
You did. I cut
that
out.
Babies with AIDS.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that's racist.
That's racist because you know they're black.
You know what kind of.
See, there he goes. Fucking low. Of course he was. All right.
Unbelievable. Hey, Talking Funny on HBO, April 22nd at 9 p.m.
This will do us no good at all.
You never know. Someone's listening to that. An Idiot Abroad. I just want to say that. I love the fucking show.
We're trying
to figure out Carl. You've known him for a long time. Some people say he's an improv guy.
No.
He is brilliant at whatever he does. He's either brilliant at being stupid
show, obviously,
or he's...
Right?
Yeah.
I love it.
It's great.
I love it. He goes...
His mind works really fast.
Well, he thinks like a comic, but he thinks so completely like a comic because he looks at a situation and it goes in and he says exactly what he's thinking and they're like honed one-liners. People think he's scripted.
Something about it, because you keep thinking when you watch the show that you're going to reach a point where he's going to become self-aware, like the computer in Terminator or whatever, and it's going to kill the comedy. But he doesn't. He stays that one way.
But he's not stupid.
Does he understand he's a comic, though? Does he understand he's funny?
Oh, no, he doesn't.
That's the weirdest thing about it.
Sometimes, not when he's angry. Rustling is just Louis just eating stuff out of a big bag, like a fucking horse.
I'm sorry, was I bothering you?
Jesus Christ. I mean, just no concession to the public at all.
Never ending.
People have taken time to listen.
Working, I'm doing very well in my career.
Yeah, I won an award.
Yeah, I did.
I'm Louis C.K.
I am Louis C.K. and I did win an award. Right.
and I crinkle the paper.
It just comes in because it's free shit.
I'm sure.
I won the
Water Award.
And I don't even know who else was nominated. I didn't
Congratulations on the Water Award, by the way.
Thank you, Opie. It was a fucking bullshit show, and they gave me a bullshit award. It fucking sucked balls.
Right.
But who the fuck is going to invite you back?
I don't care.
Tiffany Ward, you fucking asshole.
I don't care.
Hey, Brando snubbed the Oscars.
This is a Darwinist business. This is a Darwinist business. If this shit catches up to me, I will be gone.
Right.
As long as it's working, I don't care.
You're going to go with it.
Yeah, but fuck it. I don't care.
I want to go back to Carl for a second. So when he says something funny and you laugh your balls off.
He's a normal guy.
But do you see it in his eyes? Like he realizes he just made Ricky Gervais fucking laugh.
He knows that. I don't think he finds the things he's saying as funny as I do, because when he's saying them, it's usually from a point of anger.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like he's so wound up when he says something and you have to prod him and prod him. And I'm doing it for my amusement.
Sure.
A lot of people think it's bullying.
I don't see it that way at all.
It's not bullying. It's what mates do. Even Carl says. He says, well, if they're saying it's bullying, they're not doing anything about it.
You're giving them a good life.
No one's helping me.
Now, Machu Picchu was the last episode. Most people have seen it by now. He really didn't want to go the distance?
It was a lot. It'd been a long time, and he'd been away from home.
He climbs all the way up, if you know where Machu Picchu is, and he sees it in the distance, and he calls up Ricky, or it might have been Steven.
Yeah.
He goes, I'm close enough. I don't need to go any further. And I'm like, you're that close to an amazing place in the world.
But that's a good example of what that guy's like, is that he doesn't have the same values as other people.
But it's almost like that part
he doesn't need that the way anybody else would.
No, he doesn't need anything, though. He doesn't need anything. He doesn't know what he wants.
He really didn't feel like going any further.
He's looking forward to being old. Said that. He said, I'm looking forward to being old. He said, old people are no trouble. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, you just sit in a chair in the street and no one looks at you like you're lazy. That's an ambition
man.
It's just great. He's happy. He's just happy, you know, doing his own little thing.
Second season?
But he's sorted it out. I think he's got it right. I think he's absolutely got it right. He sees the world.
Yeah, he's a Buddha or something.
He's great.
Right. A lot of people spend a whole life to get to that Zen moment of just being wherever you are, and he's born with it.
I love that
you guys just shit on me for acting that way. An hour ago.
We thought it was great.
You live totally in the moment, Jay. You're like a fucking dog.
We thought that was great.
Yeah, but you do that emotionally. You do that in a negative, bad way.
Yeah,
because
like a bad dog.
All right,
bad
fair
dog.
Enough.
Like what a dog sucking his own dick. Like one of those dogs that makes you uncomfortable.
Nice dog that growls at somebody who just fed them.
I've never ever seen that in my life.
A dog sucking its own dick.
I've never seen that.
Get to YouTube.
Let's get to YouTube.
You're right. Even though they can, they don't.
This is the dog sucking his own dick right there, Jay Moore.
It's good work.
Is it on YouTube? Really, a dog sucking their own dick?
The gorilla's walking.
It's there, Louie. What are you going to say about Carl? You said you loved the fact that
he would go to Machu Picchu and look at it and go, fuck,
from
I don't
a distance.
Need, yeah, I don't need to. I don't need to.
But he wasn't impressed by anything because he's uninfluenced by peer pressure. He's a man that was never, ever bowed to any peer pressure, ever. Right. He's sorted out what he wants and nothing will change that.
Were you surprised how well the show did?
Yeah.
It kicked ass. Science Channel, right?
I think people connected with him. Yeah. I think everyone sort of knows someone like that. They're just never on the telly.
Right.
And I think that was refreshing about it. He's not an actor. He's not a presenter. You knew what he was saying was the first thing that came into his head.
Sure.
And that's gold dust because you just don't get that.
Are you going to do a second season?
Yeah, he's doing one now.
He probably didn't want to.
He didn't. No, but we lied to him.
Really?
He never hear this.
Does he care that he's famous now?
No, he hates it.
What kind of lie did you tell him?
Well, he picked his the first ones happened, for example. There's a thing on YouTube where he leaves a message on my phone, and he picked it's things to do before you die, and one of the things he picked was see a whale. So we sent him to Alaska, and we got him a boat, but he didn't know it was a working fishing boat. So once he was out there, he was fucked. And they wouldn't turn around, and it's like -20, and he leaves this message at 6 a.m, going, you fucking cunt won't turn around, I'm not the fucking doing the rest, he's going mental, and I put it on YouTube, he's got another 6 to do.
I can't.
Signed the contract, all we have to do is, once he signed the contract, then he can't give the money back.
Right.
So he's got to do it now.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it is just like the best practical joke.
Wow.
Ever, yeah, and he's He's picking things to do before you die, and that's it, really. Which he didn't understand. He I'm explaining things to you before you die. And he said, well, why would I want to do that if I'm dying? I went, no, it doesn't mean you're dying. They don't get a sick kid when he's got a week to live and throw him in with some dolphins. It doesn't mean that. I'm going to get me back to the life support machine. He thought that was it. That's the thing. Just before you die, you get chucked in with some dolphins or something. Mm-hmm. But he's quite incredible. But I sort of think he's a genius as well. Genuinely. He's
a savant.
Yeah.
I wonder if anybody ever has a
deconstructs. He looks at something and he deconstructs it and he brings it down to its rawest nub and you can't argue with it.
Is it a form of autism?
He's not. He's normally smart. He's make stuff. He's good with his hands.
Yeah.
He's, you know.
So is Carl in Sling Blade.
Yeah.
He's good with his hands.
But it's also the way, like, people used to be before they were cluttered with a bunch of extra shit to think of.
Yeah.
And he's not thinking about that. He's thinking, like, really precise, like a person alive, you know?
He says things like knowledge is hassle. So you don't need all this stuff. You know, he's got...
Well, you really don't.
No, I know.
I mean, you don't want to live a life.
But yeah, I think he's smart. I think he's got emotional intelligence beyond most people.
Yeah,
I think he's
highly
sort of
intelligent.
Yeah, I think I really think he is, and he is funny. He's hilarious, and he laughs sometimes. People never seen him laugh because, as I say, usually when we film it, we do a podcast. I've wound him up so much that he's just so angry. Mm. I suppose he's like Rain Man, but without any of the clever shit, and Tom Cruise just winding him up all the time.
All right, he's autistic, Ronnie.
And he's not. No, do you think I'm a bit like Tom Cruise?
What?
of the two, Rain Man and Tom Cruise, I'm more like Tom Cruise, aren't I?
Why would you say that? Why would that? Based on what?
Just
and I like that the other guy. I like that the other guy is Rain Man.
Dustin Hoffman.
Tom Cruise. Give him his real name. Yeah. You're like a Rain Man. He never did anything again.
You're like Tom Cruise based on the rumors about your sexuality.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. You're like Tom Cruise.
Get it?
This is surely libelous now. Do you care?
No, man. We're just going with it. We're gonna fucking air this whole thing too.
Yeah.
What about The Office, there, Ricky?
Well,
yeah, what about that? You're getting your feet wet with the American Office.
I was just popping up for a laugh.
I remember years ago you were like, you were staying away. Now you're kind of taking a peek.
We were staying away for a very good reason, that we thought that it should be made by Americans for Americans. You know, I worked in an office for 7 years, and we made that, and the attention to detail, I think, what made The Office good. And then, what's the point in doing a remake and doing it again? It just didn't seem...
Right.
I mean, originally they wanted me to play the David Brent character, and I thought, what's the point of that? I just could have kept mine going. But once it's on its own sort of 2 feet, I'm just doing it for fun, really, as a little...
What if they come to you and go, $5 million an episode?
That's what I got. I got $5 million. $5 million, though. So, yeah. So but it was good. You know, yeah. Who was that bloke? He's dead now. Marlon Brando. Didn't he get £1 million for that cameo in, like, the early...
Superman. Superman. He just walked out. They got a bag of money and he left. They actually gave him the money in the fucking scene where he looked into it.
And they worked into the scene. Said, all right, it's here.
Actually, Chuck Berry has done the same thing. You've got to have cash for him.
Yeah, there's a bunch of $1 million guys. There's a bunch of guys.
He's like $9 grand.
But whatever pay him, you got to give it to him that second.
In the guitar case. Yeah. Next to the pistol.
He actually will unplug. Put the guitar place in.
Now, he's got a bunch of things. He also wants a red Cadillac rented for him, waiting for him at the airport.
That's one of the things that probably isn't true.
His agent
has to be backstage with the money so he can see it while he's on stage.
He does. Yes, it is true. He uses local guys to play with him, too. That he hasn't practiced with, and then he walks out, plugs in while they're there. They're playing. They keep on playing. He looks at his watch. It could be like, fuck it, I'm done.
Like puts the case. Minutes.
Yeah, 35 minutes, and he's gone.
And they say, what are we playing? He says, we're playing Chuck Berry songs.
Yeah.
And he just goes, banana. It's the same song, I guess, 14 times.
Just keep doing it. But everybody will end up there. It'll be Louis one day. It'll be just
Louis
same
won't.
Thing.
No, Louis got a great attitude to money. I think he says it in Talking Funny. I don't know if we left it in, but we're talking about when Chris is saying you're the blackest white guy
that's
ever.
Right. Yes.
Countdown to poverty. Right. And,
how black people when they get Rick Chris's old bit about how when white people are rich, they're rich and their kids are rich and their grandkids.
But when a black guy gets rich, it's countdown to when he's poor again.
that's
what it's like for me, yeah.
But you said
it's melting.
You said you don't see it as your money, you see it as the money.
Yeah, it's the money. It's an element. It's like oxygen.
That's great.
It's not right to hoard it around you. You've got to keep circulating it back out into the system.
So you earn money.
That's how the economy works.
It.
I spend it right out my asshole. I just buy shit.
What'd you buy today?
Nothing. It's early. It's only fucking 10:30 in the morning.
You buy gold, though. That's smart.
What? Yeah, I bought some
gold
coins.
Smart.
Yeah.
I don't know. You could pay Louis in 3 magic beans, yeah. And he'd be happy.
I bought a bunch of gold coins. They were about $900 when I bought them. They're an ounce each, and they're now worth $1,500.
Oh, so this is true. You really did buy some gold coins.
I've been to the gold store with
gold bullion coins.
What are you thinking?
I had cash. I got paid in cash for it.
So you went out and bought some gold coins?
Got some gold coins.
That's amazing. Yeah.
And they went from $900 to $1,500 each. That's a pretty good
profit.
Just a
weird purchase, though. What else did you get? A horse and a slave?
It's strange. Right. That is weird. Did you do it as an investment, or did you think, I wonder if this will work?
What do you mean, if it'll work?
Did you do it as an investment, thinking, I wonder if I can make money of this, or was it a little whim? Or
I just wanted some gold coins.
It was shiny,
and I also knew that gold keeps going up. It always goes up.
How do you know they're real, though? Like, how do you know that's honestly 100% legit?
They're American Mint. They're U.S. Eagles or Canadian.
What do you think of this as an idea? I want to do Idiot Abroad 3.
You bite it. You bite the coin.
I wanted Carl to do this. So Carl's going to do it, we think, right? We're not sure yet. But it's called Fool's Gold. I give him £1 million. And he's got to spend every pound once, and he's got to make another million. And he thinks it's easy.
He thinks
he's got a year. I'll give him £1 million, and he's got to spend it all, and make £2 million. So make £1 million.
Once we invest, he has to buy things that would.
He's got to figure some shit out.
And I said, what would you do? He said, first thing, he said, buy some scratch cards. How many? He said, 5,000. That was his first thing.
5,000 scratch cards.
Yeah.
So $5,000 goes to scratch cards.
Yeah, and then he's just scratching it.
That's not terrible. If he gets a few 20s in there, a few 40, scratch cards,
you can make some
few hundred bucks once in a while,
Yeah, but here's the thing. If you win, say, $50, they'll say, do you want $50 or do you want me to give you 50 more scratch cards?
And that's a mistake everyone makes.
That's how they get you.
Yep.
I did that once when I forgot to buy my family presents, and I went down and I got them all like 10 scratch cards each. Right?
You forgot to buy your family
presents? Yeah, but it was late. I forgot. Yeah. And the kids, there was like nieces and nephews, like 10-year-olds, winning a fiver and then going down the shop again.
From like the smoked cigarette shop?
Exactly. Wow. They're addicted now.
The smoked cigarette shop. Whatever the fucking English fucking retards call it. Whatever these fucking worthless fucking people call their version of it.
How many people did he offend in that? English fucking retards. Just
two exactly. Really, one. They're all over there.
Oh,
fucking every retarded person is in England. It's true.
Oh God.
Wow.
I can't wait to watch Talking Funny. That's for sure. You picked the right guys too, there, Ricky. HBO, 9:00, April 22nd. I just want to keep getting that plug out there.
What
Jimmy.
Is it?
Jimmy,
were you intimidated talking to? I mean, not on a personal level because you know Louis and you know Seinfeld, but you're talking comedy and stand up.
But Chris Rock, because he's black, maybe you're intimidated.
I was trying not to say that, but it is what I meant. I mean, he might steal something.
No, I was
with three great comedians like that.
Yeah,
I mean, you're talking stand up with three guys who are legitimately great.
Yeah, I was really. All you're thinking then is, I don't want to be the least funny person in the room. I was. But then I get the back end.
No, but I loved hearing you talk about your fucking doing a new act every year.
Why do you curse so much?
Because it just makes me sound like people listen more when you curse. I'm insecure about what I'm saying, so I say fuck, and people are like, this guy's got sick cred. I liked it.
I love this guy, honestly.
One of the most honest people.
I know, I love his face. I like the way he talks. I like his
first
fashion.
Time that's ever been said.
Yeah. How can you not like that face? He's great.
Jim is lovable.
Thank you very much.
Jimmy Norton.
Well, come on, now the pressure's on me. I'm just going to start fucking bombing fucking right. To be honest, never notice me. If you don't notice me, I kill.
I remember Louis ruined your act once. He made me laugh. He said something to me when you were on stage, and you heard it.
No, that wasn't.
What happened?
Please don't tell me you're confusing me with that fucking buffoon Bob Kelly.
No, no. Oh, yeah, no, man. Yes.
Really?
Yeah, because Bob was on stage.
He's confusing me with Bob Kelly.
Bob was on stage. Bob was on stage, and you were in the room with, and I was in there with you.
The Comedy Center.
Thanks. Yeah, and I said something to you, and you laughed, and Bob got excited because he thought you laughed at his ass.
Yeah.
But you weren't even listening. I was distracting you.
I thought that was you.
No. Thank God you're wrong.
Were you on that night?
I was, but you were. I think you weren't there when I went on. I remember seeing you out.
Yeah, maybe that's the confusion.
Jim was a great comic.
Thank you.
No, I have seen you.
No, I'm happy to be confused with Bob. That's like somebody saying, like, hey, was that you in the yard? Oh, sorry, that was dog shit. I stepped in.
Your stage name is Carrot Top.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
I have a lot of funny toys I pull out.
Yeah.
I used to hit a watermelon. I was kind of him, too.
I was kind of him, too.
Yeah. Did he die or he had
Gallagher
a heart attack?
Had a heart attack on stage.
He works at the smoking cigarette shop. And he has to sell his house now.
He's still
really? Because he had a heart attack?
I don't know.
He's going to live in a van like the wrestler?
We
like
learned that he day trades when he in between radio interviews, so I guess he wasn't good at that.
He day trades?
Yeah. Franchise had him on.
His brother, and his brother toured as Gallagher 2.
No, I remember that.
Yeah, we know.
But he's
after the interview, he hangs out the entire day at the radio station and day trades.
Use your computer.
Very strange. He just sits in the hallway.
I sat with him for an hour.
Buy gold coins.
Buy gold coins.
That's the way to go.
I love buying gold coins. That's great. I just can't imagine it. Just imagine you going in like that with just all your breakfast all over you, like, and you've got a big wad of cash. And I go, good morning, sir. How much is that?
Yes, that's how it works.
Well, if the economy crashes, why would gold be worth anything? I mean,
gold
always
runs up against depression.
But I guess at one point, like, oh, here's something shiny. This is great. But now human beings have, you know, television.
But
gold keeps going up,
isn't it? Because it's finite. So they know you cannot make it.
And that's
it. You can't get it from anywhere
else. The first time I bought gold coins in the late 80s once.
This is so weird.
And they were $300 an ounce. $300 an ounce was gold. Now it's $1,500 an ounce.
Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, it's gone. It just screams upward more than anything else.
Like, multiply. That's really not that much.
But it's running the same as Coke. It's running the same as Coke.
Yeah, but no other stock is like that, you know?
I mean, sure,
Apple.
That's a good point. Why does it go up?
Yeah, it's insane because you can see, like, if you were a caveman, like, oh, it's shiny. But now, if everything goes...
If there's no water to drink, nobody's going to give a shit that you're holding gold.
That was the best
gold,
radio face in history, by the way. No one will get that. But that
if there's no water to drink, I'm not going to worry about my gold coins and how much they... Fuck, my coins are worth shit.
I disagree. There's no water.
That's
going to
be what I'm worried about.
Now my fucking gold coins
are worth... My daughters
are
skeletons, and I'm worried about my gold coins.
It just seems like if you have gold coins, they're going to die with you because you'll never...
You're not going to be done with some gold coins and a pirate hat next week. That's what I think. Now, gold has,
move it around? You know, when it's against, like, stocks or shares, or one country gives another country $20 trillion dollars, is that gold move somewhere?
I don't understand it.
I don't understand it.
Fort Knox has this massive gold reserve in it.
Yeah.
But no one, it might not exist. No one goes and looks at it. No one goes and makes sure it's in there. Have you seen it?
I just wanted to be a part of it. Felt good to jump in and have the floor for a second.
That Bob Kelly is amazing.
Yeah, he's terrific.
I got tire tracks in my back. Ronnie ran right over me for the punchline.
Well, our money used to be on the gold standard. That's what the pounds are in your, pounds sterling.
When we used to have
American dollars, really old ones are called silver certificates.
But there must be a movement of gold, though, because otherwise... You could say to another country, here, we'll buy this and give them money that doesn't exist.
Yeah.
There must be something to show for it. There must be some sort of token.
How many stones did you lose?
How many stone?
It's almost a stone. It's about 22 pounds.
Attaboy.
But, thanks.
You lost a lot more than 22
pounds.
You'll
edit out everything that's happened between those two statements.
Right. Yeah.
How much do you need to go 22 pounds? I go, thanks. Talking Funny is on the 22nd of April.
Oh, they won't plug that.
No.
That'll be cut.
No. Stories about your friends.
No, that's just not like radio. It's just like hanging out.
Well, that's how we try to do our show, Rick.
This is the best way to do it.
Hearing Seinfeld, you said something interesting about how comedy is empathy. And, I thought, wow, he's right. And then Seinfeld goes, no, it's not.
No, it's just
and then I was like, fuck, that's actually a good point by Seinfeld.
I don't know. I think it is empathy. I think you have to like someone. I think you have to understand what they're saying. I think everything has to be personified. You can't make jokes about the inanimate. But he was saying you are above the
about
audience.
The what?
About the inanimate.
The
inanimate?
Inanimate. Something that
I didn't hear
no...
the T at the end.
All right, sorry.
Maybe Jesus. To laugh at somebody, you have to like them, but, you know, Seinfeld is a weird, he doesn't really fit into, every comic has something wrong with them that I know, like they're sex addicts or drug addicts or gamblers, and with him, I can't figure out what his fucking psychosis or problem
we'll find
is.
Find out after he dies, it'll all come out.
It certainly will, his computer will be open.
Got one. I don't buy that, that you have to be, you know, have visibly something wrong with you. I think you have to be aware of your own inadequacies and play on them, but I don't think you have to wear it on your sleeve.
Not necessarily, but every comic I know has something wrong with them. They don't even necessarily. Hold on, I'm having a pissing match here. They don't have to. They don't have to wear it on their sleeve, but they actually all have something. That
Seinfeld said you have to be above the audience.
Yeah.
No. He said,
that's what Bob said.
No, wait.
Catch a coffee.
Yeah. No, what he was saying, I was saying that you can't be above the audience. You have to sort of fall over for their pleasure. Right. In a way, you have to put yourself below the audience. Show them you've had a worse day than them. Yeah. Funny. He was saying, but you're already above them because you've got the mic. They're all looking at you. You're the only one talking.
Right.
I thought it was. I think Jerry
doesn't look at, I mean, you have this really humane version of comedy, and it comes from sort of like Laurel and Hardy and Chaplin and stuff.
Yeah, the best lovable. Quote.
But Jerry is a technician. He's about the jokes. Jerry looks at comedy like music. Like he used to tell me he was like
he just
playing
like
a horn.
To write new songs.
On paper,
he just likes to get, he gets off on the material.
What's
he gets
the deal?
Off heavily on the material and how he does it. And he is, you know, when I was young, I used to open for Jerry. When I was like 18, 19, I got to open for him in one gig in Boston, and he liked me, so he took me to a bunch. And it was an enormous experience because I kind of didn't think when I was that age, like, he wasn't my favorite guy. I liked Stephen Wright, and I liked Carlin and Pryor. And I thought he was good, but I didn't really know of him that much. But watching him do, you know, hour-long shows and theaters, and this is before he had his show. When he was just a top-rank heavyweight comic, watching him do that, the fucking guy is a virtuoso. He is like a great, like Vladimir Horowitz. He's a fucking genius
and
at
so
putting on
well.
A comedy show.
It
he works so
in the
hard
room.
For his audience.
Yeah, he does, yeah. But he's also, he's almost professorial about it as well. He's got everything worked out.
He's in control. He's very much into being in control. And we identified that, too, on the show, that, like, he when he did my joke about the vacation going around the car, he did it in this very controlled
and it was
Seinfeldian
like a one line,
way.
Wasn't it? Was it
yes,
that rhythm?
That's my vacation.
What I was saying that Louis,
when I do it,
he's angry.
Yeah.
We're laughing at him because he can't get it out.
I'm sweating and I'm sputtering.
I mean, they're there. Yeah. They're all there. They're all sort of disguised and hidden. But we're laughing at a man's breakdown. We're feeling it more viscerally. We're not looking at the dots on paper. And I think that a lot with comedians, when you see the comedians, and they could be great one-liner with the puns, but you feel that you haven't learned about them. You feel that you could read them out yourself and get just as good a laugh.
Well, there's almost no right answer. That's what I... It's
there
like,
isn't. Why would there be?
When you look at Pryor and Carlin, I think they're the two greatest, and they were completely different. Pryor was extraordinarily personal. Carlin told you nothing personal, but was still an observational genius and a social genius. And Pryor was, too, but he did it through a person. They both took different vehicles to get to the same place.
Well, also, Carlin did bits, and he worked them out. He had really well-phrased stuff. And Pryor would just talk. Pryor would just talk and talk, and but he would hit beautiful moments that you know were precise for him.
Yeah.
Carlin said
like
he really
that.
Turned the corner when he said, he used to say, I'm a comedian that writes his own material. And then he started saying, I'm a writer who performs his own material. And he realized he was writing essays. And he was doing a one-man show in like four pieces.
Yeah.
Like a bit about Earth, and he would just do a one-man show.
That's right.
I tried to do that when I started off. It's too hard.
Yeah.
It's too hard. So now I just get bits, and I pretend to work them together. Like
you had the
now.
Best quote in Esquire, and you said, Laurel and Hardy is like the basic root of comedy is Laurel and Hardy. It's never been improved upon. I'd be so much better off if I wasn't with this idiot.
Yeah.
Like,
that's
you
it.
Just can't improve that.
No, and that's what it's
and
about
ever since
as well.
You said that, they just started showing it, like, on these bizarre channels, and I watch it, and I go, but fucking it's... Ricky Gervais
But it's even deeper than that, because it's like the blind leading the blind. They both think they'd be better off without the other one. And one is more stupid than the other one, because he thinks he's cleverer than the other one.
I have nothing to say to you.
It's lovely. It's just lovely. It's just great. And, see, Louis stand-up, I think, is good, because he's really sort of like a threat, because he shambles out like an underdog whose life's falling apart, but then he's really clever. And he's got his targets are all correct. Even though they don't look like they are, they're all correct targets. He goes after
like retards
people.
Fucking in England.
Well, you know, that's what you say about being above it or I'm mm-hmm. hung up on the, you know, empathetic. So are you, though. The jokes you make, they're clearly, actually, if they look cruel, they're not. They're not at all.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think... people know that I'm being an asshole.
Of course.
I don't mind people thinking I'm an asshole.
Yeah, but they get like, it. They get it on a subliminal level because they know you can't be.
I don't know anyone that thinks you are.
What's that?
I don't know a single human being that thinks you're an asshole.
Oh, there are definitely people.
I don't know anyone. I've never met anyone.
Not the people that go to your show.
What did you say? They go, oh, Louis is hilarious. Or like if I said it,
but I
would not have a job.
I mean, it's like when I do, there's things I do on my show where I take on certain subjects. And when I'm doing something that's kind of controversial, what I do is I make sure that I lose.
You're fighting the story. But whenever you're angry,
you're the rape victim.
Yes, exactly. If we're doing rape, I'm getting raped.
Smell the glove.
And you're fighting an unreasonable world. You're always fighting an unreasonable world. You're fighting with what, you know, the hand you would doubt. And also, I like the fact you also start off, and I don't know if you do this consciously or not, but people like you because you're bringing up two little girls. So they know whatever you're doing, you're bringing up two little girls. And I think and I think people have got to like you. As an example, the Marx Brothers, right? They're the biggest things involved.
You don't
right?
have children, right?
No.
Mm.
I don't know what that means. Mm. I don't know what the means. the Marx Brothers, funny, everyone loved them doing stuff, right? They transfer to films, and it's sort of exhausting, too long to be doing zany stuff. So the eventual producer director of the best films, they came and said, listen, I can make you, you know, so much bigger. And he said, we're putting a musical number, and we're putting a love story. So now, it's these idiots, right? But they're being idiotic and running around because they're trying to get two lovers together. So now everyone wants them to win because they're
you know
doing
what,
something
though?
Worthwhile I, with their stupidity.
You,
and their...
You know what, though? I hate those Marx Brothers movies. I like the earlier ones when they're just being fucking nuts. When
I
they're just
agree with Louis on
disturbing.
This because he won the award last night.
It's true. When they do that. I think I'm in the minority.
It's an award-winning opinion.
That's right. It is. I was given an award for having this opinion.
I think it's the humanity again because Groucho is always the underdog. Even though he thinks he's cleverer than that guy, he's getting conned. He looks, you know...
No, that's what they were like. But when they put in the couples and had them sing to each other and the Marx Brothers became like a B story, those love stories were synthetic, horseshit, bad Hollywood love stories.
As opposed to the Marx Brothers act?
The great Marx Brothers movies like Animal Crackers that were just fucking crazy stories that made no sense, that were driven by this great comedy.
But you need the adhesion because it's exhausting. Even, you know, like you can come out and I can watch you for... an hour telling me a story. That's the human aspect. You can tell a story and I can watch you for an hour, right? If you come out and you do the best 1,000 one-liners, I'm looking at my watch after 20 minutes.
Yeah, no, when you purify comedy into just a fastball, but you know.
Yeah, I think that
there are guys. I think it's just everybody's just different. You can't, you know, there's some people who are empathetic and personal and there's other people who just got the fucking jokes. Like
after
like
No
Hedberg.
Filter, his album's going to be Everybody's Just Different.
Everybody's Just Different.
Yeah, but the same underneath, if you turn it over,
that's
and it's
right.
just him leaning on his hands.
Leaning on his hands.
Put the same underneath, like that'll be the album. Everybody's Just Different, and I'm wearing like a leather jacket with the collar up, like Dennis Leary in the 80s. And then on the other side, but the same underneath, folded hands.
I'll get you to tell some of the stories you told on Talking Funny, but that would ruin it, wouldn't it?
I don't remember any of what
you told the best anecdotes. They're all. That's,
I don't remember.
You tell.
You were great, man.
That.
You were really good. It
was a
really
fun good. Day.
When is the show going to be on television?
I saw Seinfeld.
It was a thrill to me.
With more respect, as that 4 hours went, I saw Seinfeld looking over at you more and more, thinking this guy's good.
Well, Jerry, I he used to kind of haze me a lot because we knew each other when I was fucking
18. Why do you keep writing new material?
Why do you keep getting bigger the same hour when I'm sort of the same as I was before?
Have you ever noticed socks?
You gotta
I
change.
Want my feet not to have shoes, but I need something between me and the floor.
But I have enormous, like, awe, respect for Jerry and Chris and you. I mean, when I saw The Office, I wouldn't have said it. You think I felt like I had to? I would have fucking loved if I didn't feel it inside.
Then you would have seen how those things hurt.
How fun that would have been to say I had enormous respect for Jerry and Chris and then just watch your eyes kind of notice it. Yeah. I would have loved that. I can't do it.
Or you could have just said Jerry, Chris, and Bob Kelly and humiliated me too.
How smart is Jerry, though, that he's the one that got Larry David? In the middle of all the comedy boom and all, he was the one that, I created it. A show with Larry David, which was, Larry, you write, and I'll do my acting.
And Larry couldn't get arrested back then. Larry
but to
was
be able to
struggling. Recognize
that, but to be able to get
but
that.
You know, would you sound like you know that Larry did more of the heavy lifting? With
no,
the
I think he that
no, Larry
the
was
stuff that
his
he wrote,
show.
He wrote
his,
all the...
Seinfeld was all Larry.
Yeah, you can say that. I assumed it was...
Oh, you could tell.
Well, I mean, Jerry.
How do we know who Larry is?
It came from Jerry's...
Who is you?
Oh, sorry.
Why don't you shut your fucking mouth?
I'm sorry.
What the fuck? This is exactly like The View. I'm just whenever I'm talking, if someone says, what the fuck are you talking?
Well, we say the show is kind of like the inmates run the asylum, curb.
It's like an upside down.
It's like an experiment. It does feel like I'm part of an experiment. Now you're going to go out and you're going to fucking rape and shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we should leave a sign on the door or something.
All right. Rape is not an experiment. It's a proven, it's pretty well perfected. At this point.
What's that?
Rape.
Oh, it certainly is.
Wait, I mean, you shouldn't do it, but it works perfectly.
Yeah,
you do.
Somebody's not minding their P's and Q's. Right.
I think with that, we should get out of here.
Man.
Oh,
when is
I'm on television.
Always end on a rape gag.
Why not? You got it. Every time.
Rule one. Rule one. Bob Hope. Oh, Bob Hope used to be
Bob Hope did the rape joke.
Yeah. I always lean with a rape joke.
Yeah. He wouldn't win the Oscar.
I know the truth. Rape.
Yeah.
Well, he raped a girl back in Bangkok.
He didn't win the Comedy Central Award, did he?
That's true.
That's right. Thank you.
No way.
Thank you.
You beat out Ricky and Whitney Cummings.
You know, they don't let you keep the fucking award.
Who's the fucking fourth person you beat?
No. They took the thing for they take
you
the
never
thing
told
from
us
you.
What that
that's
thing
so they
was.
Can engrave it.
You came off. I went. They told me I won it a month before. When did they fucking.
Well, on the award show, they couldn't just hand it. That says, hi, here, Louis.
No one's. Everybody got the same one. I'm sure no one's
what
getting it.
What does it look like? You never told
it's
us.
It's a microphone on a black thing.
Yeah.
Stupid.
Yeah.
It's fucking
awful.
Microphone.
Yeah.
Terrible.
And you're never getting that award.
But here's the thing.
You're never getting it because it was a bust. Nobody cared about it. So I swear they're going to go, why are we going to engrave them?
Do you know why I like winning awards? Because I know there's loads of people out there that hate me even more for it and think I shouldn't have won it. And that gives me a bigger buzz
than
the people who go, well done. I know there's someone somewhere
that feels good.
In an apartment going, I fucking hate him and shouldn't have fucking won it.
Here's the thing, too. Right. We don't know. This could be big, and he's like Wings of Desire. He won the first year. Those guys didn't show up. They went, I don't give a shit. Well, some stupid thing. And now you were there for the first.
But I like to think that my... The special that didn't win is like Citizen Kane not winning.
That's true. And people talk about that years from now.
Yeah.
You believe the
Raging
bullshit?
Bull with your little fucking flesh-colored microphone on your face. Your fucking headset microphone that's flesh-colored.
And now Colin has
one.
Wondering.
Like your fucking Sammy Hagar.
He's not real stand-up. He doesn't hold it with one hand.
That's right. Take this shitty thing out of your voice and it's correct. He's not really a stand-up. He doesn't hold it with his hands.
I saw you. It was actually impressive. I thought you were just talking really loud for a while.
Yeah.
Wow, this guy's good.
Really, yeah.
You're a great performer, man. I watched you at the Paramount, I think.
Ricky's great.
I very rarely go to see stand-ups, but it was a very impressive show. It was fucking great.
Thank you very much. Let's end on that, surely.
Yeah.
That's the quote.
Ricky has great patience on stage. Ricky has Ricky like invests in little moments on stage. That's a hard thing to do.
I deserve more than it got.
With that, Ricky, thanks.
I have to ask
Ricky,
do you really like me, or is it really Bob Kelly we're thinking of?
No, I do like you.
Thank you.
But I got confused because I wasn't watching him. Obviously, because he was making me laugh about something. So I remember talking to you that night.
I was a little hurt.
I'm sure I've seen you as well. No, I think you're great.
Probably on HBO or
whatever. I like your style. It's like I've said. I like the fact that it's visceral and it's angry and it's.
Do you remember one joke he did?
No.
That's the beauty of it. Whenever you see a great show, you don't remember the jokes. You just remember the feeling of being elevated that you experience, as opposed to my fucking
perfect
nonsensical joke.
You want to talk to him? You talk to him.
Yeah. You're not dying, Ricky. You're killing everyone around you.
He had a big bag of props, and he got them out. He did a different joke about every single one of them. And none of it was planned. He was just getting them out of the audience, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Was like they just filled my prop bag, and I'm like, oh, what is this?
Improv.
Oh. All right, we got to get Ricky out of here. Come back with Carl, will you?
Yeah, well, no.
For the second season,
yeah,
can you bring Carl next time?
I think you should get Carl on and just ask him questions for an hour to show that he's the real thing and get people to find him.
All right, we'll set that up. We'll get Carl on. Ricky Gervais, thanks. Talking Funny, I think everyone's going to check it out. April 22nd at 9 p.m. on HBO. Always a pleasure, sir. We'll see you soon.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Opie and Anthony Show on the Virus. Sirius XM.
I thought the Ricky Gervais interview was way more uncomfortable than the Paul Reiser interview. Because when Ricky Gervais came in, he came in with Louis C.K. And Louis C.K. and Ricky Gervais set themselves up in the corner like fucking besties. Like fucking girls at a lunchroom. And every fucking joke that Jimmy, Ronnie, me, or Opie said, they completely fucking ignored. And then Louis would go, you're a fat fuck. And Ricky Gervais would go, oh, he's a fat fuck, did he? I mean, if you listen to that interview, then Jimmy has reduced himself playing the guy that just states pragmatic facts. Like, they're talking about almost dying on a private plane. Like it was fucking, that to me was uncomfortable, though. The fucking ball washing of fucking Louis and Ricky.
Wow.
They were.
Everyone was licking fucking Jerry Seinfeld's balls, and I'm like, am I really in a room with people that are just going on and on about what an incredible comic Jerry Seinfeld is?
Yeah.
And Louis going, he's amazing. He's a maestro. It's like watching the world's, who's the greatest violin guy that everybody references?
Yo-Yo Ma.
No, you know, it's just like the old-time guy. He's like watching
Stradivarius.
It's like Stradivarius, like watching a composer, like one of the world's most brilliant, Tchaikovsky. And I'm like, he does the same fucking 50 minutes, and he gives it all to it. Louis said, and he gives it all to his audience every night. I never saw anything like that in my life. And I'm like, are we thinking of the same guy that does this?
Yeah. They were definitely two little schoolgirls in the lunchroom.
Were they really?
Not including anyone else. And then, like, Louis wanted Ricky's opinion on something he shot to see if Ricky thought it was funny.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking to myself, there's a lot of other funny guys in this room that maybe want to take a look at that, too.
Oh, really?
So Jay's onto something. They had their own little thing going.
I tapped out when Louis said, do you ever let anybody else fucking talk? And I went, all right.
Oh, yeah, you got mad at Jay.
Oh, shit.
I forgot about that.
But I don't know if it was real mad. I mean, that's the one thing I always wished I could change. I know I fucking talk too much. It's something I'm fucking constantly working on.
Oh, man, he said that to
obviously,
you.
Obviously,
huh?
You're not working on that right now, though.
Oh, now.
I didn't say a word when you were telling your whole Make Fez cry story.
I think I kept the interest in the storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
Jay, could you do, please do one more Louis C.K. Ricky Gervais over the top laugh, please. I know you guys don't like requests, but
are you just going to sit there and eat, have everybody hear you chew? That's the nothing. Nothing's happening. Nothing. There's nothing happening whatsoever except Louis chewing, fucking rolling through a brown paper bag to get more food. Just put the bag on your fucking face like a fucking horse. Well, you're a fucking stupid retard. That's where retards go. They go to fucking England. All England retard fucking baby retarded fuckers. England. Yes. How many people have you offended with retarded fucking sentence? How many? Just one. You fucking fat fucking retard. Fucker, fat cock, fuck shit in Sarah Palin's mouth shit.
Oh, please.
Look, I love those guys.
Holy
fuck. But that is fucking right on.
That is like a right on Louis and a right on Gervais. Wow.
Straight up fucking, we suddenly are more famous than everyone else you have in here, and we're going to fucking sit in a corner of your place.
Holy shit. I love the over the top Ricky Gervais laugh.
But then, the Louis is perfect.
But Ricky, and look, like, how the fuck is Louis not fired? Can you imagine if I tweeted that I'm going to rape fucking black babies with eight? Like, I mean, Louis gets away with the crazy. God bless him. And I talked to Louis off the air. I go, how the fuck can you tweet that you're going to take a shit in Sarah Palin's mouth and FX doesn't go, hey, man, we're going to pull it. Like, how does that not get picked up?
Because he's that damn good, I guess.
But I was watching Norm MacDonald's sports show, and I sat there and counted the jokes that if I said, I would have been fucking fired.
Oh, really?
You know, I've been listening to Yogi Berra quotes all these years, and now I just think he's retarded. Barack Obama, they say, is the greatest basketball-playing president of all time. But as far as a regular black guy, he's average. I mean, I would get emails and they would just say, regular black guy?
Yeah. Oh, shit. Wow, man.
Fucking Louis and I were on an airplane, a private jet, right? And we're flying into Lowell, Massachusetts. And Louis going, fuck, nigga baby, fuck them in the ass, right? Because he's afraid to die on the airplane. He's gonna fuck nigga babies. That helps me get out of my fucking my comfort zone. My fuck you, you British fucking shit fucker faggot fucker. Jerry's the best I've ever seen. Jerry's incredible. Jerry, Louis said I used to open for Jerry. I opened for Jerry. And I couldn't believe watching in the wings, watching what a virtuoso he was on stage. And I wanted to go, virtuoso at what? Like, what the fuck are you talking about? You're in the room with some fucking grand slam hitters, man. Like, it's me, Louis, and Jim, and Ricky Gervais, and he's talking about how fucking Seinfeld's a virtuoso. Like, really? Let's see him get heckled.
Holy shit.
The fucking ball washing that went on.
Yeah.
God damn it. I Ricky Gervais.
I am sorry I missed that one, man.
That's a good bit.
That sounded.
And Ricky was good, but it was. They literally set up where E-Rock sits, and Ricky took out his computer and started writing because, God forbid, he takes 10 minutes off. He was writing fucking stuff on his computer during the entire interview. He's that fucking in control of everything. That's like I have to write during an interview. I'm fucking the guy here.
He's prolific. That's why.
And then fucking Ricky Gervais loved the room, loved the energy. But every time Louis spoke, he goes, "Oh!" And then Jimmy was saying the funniest shit I've ever. Jimmy was doing the guy that just like the neighbor that states the obvious. They're like, "We're on a private jet, and it's about to fucking crash." It's bouncing all over the skies. And Jimmy goes, oh, that makes me nauseous when that happens. Sometimes I have to take Dramamine. Nothing. And they're just fucking, they were just freezing us out like fucking Isaiah and Magic at the All-Star game, freezing out Jordan.
Wow. Just passing each other. Now we need a clip of that interview.
Yeah. I'd love to hear
the line I had that didn't land was Louis, Ricky was picking Louis up in a private jet, and Louis was fucking late, right? I forgot my keys. I forgot. Were you a fucking English fucking retard? I was late to my fucking. He goes, yeah, we went to Lowell, Mass. I can't do Louis good, so I'll just talk. And Louis said, I had Mickey Ward train me. You know, Mickey Ward, the fighter from Lowell, Mass. Remember, he came on the private plane with us because he trained me for my upcoming my stand-up special. And I thought, who the fuck is sitting across from me? That's something Louis would mock if anyone else said, wait, you had a fucking boxing trainer train you to tell fucking jokes?
Oh, shit.
I mean, let's fucking call a spade here, Anthony. Now, by the way, if fucking I sat there and said, well, I had an HBO special coming up, so I had Mickey Ward, I had a boxing guy training me to get me in shape for my special, he'd go, what are you, a fucking retard? That's a fucking fact, and you know it. We become what we hate.
Wow, man.
And then I said, then he goes, and the reason I was late, we had to get there. We were in Lowell, Mass, on a plane, and we had to pick up Mickey Ward because he was training me for my HBO special to get me in shape for my special. And in my mind, I'm going, are you fucking boxing in your special? What the fuck are you talking about? And then he goes on and on, and Louis goes, yeah. And the reason I was late is because my fucking dog got hit by a car. And that's why I was late, so I hope you're happy. And then I said quietly, driven by Mickey Ward. No one even fucking picked their heads up.
Nothing.
It was a fucking ice festival. It was the seniors and the freshmen were sitting at their fucking table. Look at the game tape if you don't believe me.
Wow, I didn't know you had such a problem with Louis C.K.
I don't have a problem.
Oh, he doesn't have a problem.
No, no problems, right?
No, no problem.
He's a great guy. I love him.
No problem.
Like when me and Voss left the studio, Opie goes, so you guys, are your problems okay? Like, we don't have a, there's no problem.
No problems. No problems. Just some observations.
Louis C.K. saying that he had hired a boxing trainer for his HBO special, I thought, if you told him 4 years ago that he's going to be in a studio and a comic's going to say that, he would have eviscerated said comic, and then you would have went, no, it's going to be you.
Yeah.
Don't tell me I'm wrong on that, Ope.
No, I think Jay's right on that one.
It's a great observation.
But people do, change, I guess. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Opie, you're That's telling hilarious. Me during that interview, you didn't feel like
I said it was a good observation. Those two were definitely on the same page.
I know, but good observations, like, on the fence, like, so you can jump over to Louis, like, if Louis goes, look, let me tell you what.
Well, when Louis tells his side, I'll go, wow, that's a good observation.
Great observation.
Now Jay's calling me out.
Okay, you know what? All right, Anthony. The fucking tape speaks for itself.
Yeah.
15 minutes into the interview, I look over. Opie's playing Space Invaders.
I think it was Angry Birds, but.
Fuck you, Opie, and fuck Michael Jackson.
Wow. That's harsh.
God damn, Jay.
People are loving this shit. Loving the Ricky Gervais, by the way.
It's so goddamn funny.
They're loving it.
It's.
The whole show is Ricky Gervais, Chris Rock, Louis C.K., and.
Jerry Seinfeld
talking about comedy. Mm-hmm. And they were just fucking ball-washing Jerry. And then in turn, ball-washing Lou. Did you feel, Opie, did you feel during that interview like a freshman sitting with seniors at lunch?
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, really? Yeah, it was absolutely. That vibe?
Yeah.
Wow.
It was a very fucking rarefied, like, this is, we're different.
That's a little uncomfortable.
It was pretty weird.
And was there any sign that, Jay, that you felt like you were the problem?
Well, no, I didn't.
Louis yelled at him.
That's what I mean.
No, that was before it happened. That was before the interview he yelled at me, before Ricky came in. But if you listen to the interview, you'll be amazed at how little I talk.
Really?
Yeah, they shut him down.
I sat there going, I had two things that didn't land, and I went, wow, this is fucking different. All right.
Then that's it. Just fucking back out.
Yeah, Jay shut down.
Wow.
And that's saying a lot, if I was actually quiet.
Now I want to hear this. Yeah.
Yeah, well,
I'm going to have to give a listen.
We might have to pull clips now.
Ron Bennington shut down.
Yeah, Ronnie.
Wow.
Ronnie B.
Me, Opie, and Ronnie, and then Jimmy's going like, yeah. Oh, and the best is when Ricky Gervais said, I love his face about Jimmy and thought he was Bobby Kelly.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, it made Jimmy sad.
He goes, I remember you were at the Comedy Cellar and you were on stage and Louis said something to me to make me laugh and I wasn't laughing at you and I laughed really loud and you thought I was laughing at you and I wasn't laughing at you. But it was so embarrassing. And he goes, please don't tell me you're mistaking me for that blob of shit.
Yeah, Jimmy did say that.
Blob of shit.
I think Jimmy pretty much said it that way. Yeah.
And he was. He thought he was Bob Kelly.
Yeah. That made Jimmy sad.
Wow, man.
Jimmy never got over that for the rest of the interview.
Oh, I don't doubt it. No, Jimmy will latch on to something. Because
then Ricky half-heartedly said, no, I do know who you are.
Oh.
You know, one of those.
Oh. So.
All right, Jay Moores.
Wow, man.
Ronnie B. and Louis said, you always live in the moment. You're like a fucking dog. You're like a fucking dog. Like, you just lick your own balls. And just live in the moment. You have this crazy ability. You're just this fucking annoying, stupid fuck. You just live in the moment, like moment. It's like a little kid, Ronnie B. said, that lets go of the fucking handlebars, and he doesn't give a fuck what happens. Like that moment of floating in the air. That's you. You live in the moment. Fucking fast forward 20 minutes. They're talking about Carl from Ricky Gervais' show. And they go, it's really amazing. He lives only in the moment. He's like a Buddha. He's really like a Buddha. And that's like really the key to life is really to just live in the moment And then I go, you just said I'm a fucking dog for living in the moment. And then Louis goes, yeah, but like you're like a bad dog.
Oh, shit. Wow, man.
Paul Reiser was a fucking breeze.
Yeah, that was easy.
Paul, wow, and then I was going, oh, Anthony, you'll like it because I did Harvey Keitel doing Paul Reiser's act. Listen to me. Men use the bar of soap for the middle of their chest. There's no reason why we have to soak the middle of their chest, but men love that spot. Every time we step in the shower, we soak the middle of our chest.
Shit, man. See, that's fucking funny.
Oh, we had a good week, man. I'm glad you're back. That shit is hard.
Yeah, we had fun.
Fucking 4 hours good shit. Talking, people calling you up, telling you you suck.
Yeah, what do you, yeah, right? What do that's a treat, isn't it?
Goes with the job.
Fucking assholes.
As they do nothing with their lives. Isn't that wonderful?
This is my new thing that I do. If I'm going to go on a radio or a TV show, I go on that message board for whatever show it is. And it's like a TV show or whatever, like Criminal Intent or whether it's Leno. And when they're all, like, talking shit, and anything that's funny on that message board, I bring to the show, and I take their own jokes, and I shove it up their ass.
Clever strategy.
The problem is, there's absolutely nothing funny on any message board.
No.
So, Anthony, welcome home, my lover.
Thank you, Mr. Jay Morse.
Anthony made Fez cry just by taking out his cock.
Ah, Jesus.
Yeah, the Fez crying.
Ah, jeez.
Ah, Jesus.
Yeah, I got sucked into the Fez crying thing. It's very bizarre. No. Especially when you know you're not trying to make him cry.
Poor lad.
And it's not a bit.
No,
I don't think it's
going
a bit
on
at
too
all.
Long.
Nope.
It's a bit that's been going
on
forever.
Why isn't it the Ron and Pepper show? Or the Ron, like, what is it?
I don't know. I try to.
That's not a question for us to answer.
I just try to. I don't know. Look at it with compassion and
understanding.
Understanding, yes. Mm-hmm. And see what happens.
Yep. See how it plays out.
Yeah.
Yep.
Eastside Dave McDonald. I mean, there's a lot of guys going around.
The reason, the fact that they got rid of him, speaks volumes.
About the company?
I like how
they got a Twitter campaign for Dave. The theory being, if the company sees how many Twitter followers you get, then they'll say, holy shit.
Yeah, get him back.
And he got up to about 6,000.
And the guy didn't even want a big raise. That's the sad part. He just wanted enough money to survive. And they said no to that.
Commuting money.
Just unbelievable.
Why are there fucking DJs, when I listen to Sirius and I'm listening to, like, Lithium, why is there a person in the middle of the day to go, all right, that was Cherub Rock, Siamese Dreams, man. Like, yeah, I know, stupid. It says it on the fucking radio.
they feel they need jocks.
You don't have to say that shit anymore. You're right. You either know the song, if you don't, you look down at the display.
Yeah, and then you see it.
Oh, that's who does this. Okay.
And every channel has their bizarre jocks. Like, just get rid of all, hey, Sonny Fox on the Comedy Channel. We're going to be, I know who you're going to be interviewing,
well,
it says it.
Well, that was the difference with XM. XM tried to teach their guys, you know, to throw out all that radio shit that you learned. This is different. But Sirius took the approach where we're radio. Yeah. So do your radio thing. Yeah, they do the laundry list of the songs they just played when they're right there on the fucking display.
Yeah.
Doesn't make sense, Jay Moore, with another correct point.
My Charlie Sheen Criminal Intent got moved up to Sunday the 1st. It was the 4th episode. They moved it up to the premiere episode.
So you're going to be on Sunday the 1st. That's next Sunday.
Yeah, the premiere episode.
Wait, that's this Sunday.
Yes, stupid.
All right. I just looked at the calendar. That's exciting.
It's going to be next Sunday, the 1st. That's this Sunday.
I know. Hey, man, look at the time. It's time to go home.
But that's good. And just so your listeners know, I'm supposed to look like that. I'm playing a cracked out fucking wacko that's like bloated on drugs. Everybody goes, wow, Jay Moore's fucking looks a little beat up. I'm like, yeah, I've been in the show. They put makeup on me to make me look crazy.
Yeah, right. You're supposed to look all coked out and shit. Yeah, because I made a little video and I took a couple pictures on set and people are like, wow, he looks like shit. It's like, he's playing Charlie Sheen.
If you really want to see what I look like, go to Opie's Eye on YouTube when I'm in my underwear and I walk down the street, West village.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Boys Town. And Opie points out that from the belly button up, I look like a defensive back. And from the belly button to my knee, I look like Kevin James.
It's a little confusing.
Jesus
and then your dog had a play day with some guy's gay dog.
it was a gay dog party, man.
They had a little play date in the middle of the village.
Were they humping each other? Yeah?
I don't know what the fuck was going on.
Jesus.
Anthony, where are my gays at when I go do shows? I mean, I'm walking around the West Village with a Louis Vuitton scarf walking to Teacup York.
Yeah.
Kathy Griffin ain't doing that.
You should have gained some gays.
You should have definitely gotten some gay.
Should have gotten some gays.
Yeah. All
right, let's get the gay out of the show now.
We have. We've done pretty good.
Let's get the Opie and Anthony out of the show. Jesus Christ.
Right, come on. Home,
I ain't working overtime today.
You. Good to see you. Anthony, welcome home.
Jay Moores, thank you, my friend.
Any threesomes on the boat?
You're a good egg. Nah, I'm a good boy these days.
No, you can have good boy.
Yeah. A
couple beautiful girls.
A couple beautiful girls. Kit Kat Club.
Who were these people? I love you, boys.
All right, Jay.
Thanks, Jay.
Thanks for calling in.
Louis eating food next to me. Louis